Hello, good morning. I'm Peter Roslani, an alumni from Social Design, and I have the pleasure to introduce Ruth Wodak, an emeritus distinguished professor of discourse studies at Lancaster University in the UK. About her great work and different publications, research projects, and numerous awards, you can read in the program and on the website. It would take a long time to just repeat it. I would prefer to talk about the moment when I got a bit familiar with her work. I was participating in a project at the Social Design Studio, which title was borrowed from her latest book, Politics of Fear, which is dealing with the discourse, the rhetoric, and argumentation of populist right-wing politicians across Europe. The book served as an important foundation to approach the complex and controversial topic of constructed fears and to discuss them in public space. Today, she will talk about the right-wing populism on both sides of the Atlantic. So please welcome Ruth Wodak.
Good morning. Thank you very much for this introduction, and thank you for inviting me. I'm obviously a normal scholar and not an artist, although maybe all scholars are artists, or I don't know how we should sort of frame our profession. But I'm very honored to be here and to speak. I'm also really amazed and happy that some writing of mine has had an impact also on further development in art and design. I don't know what's happening around here. So let's see if it holds. So when Brigitte's letter reached me, I was really very honored and happy to be invited. And as I know Brigitte for a long time, I think, I don't know, I don't even want to say for how long yet. I accepted, and of course I'm open to questions about the more linguistic. So now we turned off the heating, and maybe that will work. Otherwise I will just speak without PowerPoint, but that means that you won't see the pictures I actually want to talk about, which are part and parcel of this presentation. Okay, what I want to do today is first define important dimensions of right-wing populism. This is, of course, only a brief summary. There's much more to say, but I think I have about half an hour to speak, so I will try not to go over. Then I will briefly introduce my theoretical framework of what I call border and body politics, which are at the heart of this politics of fear as I define it. And the notion of borders has already been mentioned by the president of the university and also by Brigitte. So obviously we're right now living in a time where borders are at the center of the debate. Yeah? And borders are not static. They are being created time and again. And then I will give you two examples. One is about what I call protecting our country and what that implies rhetorically, but also theoretically and semiotically. And the second one is how past and present are blended. Again, also semiotically, I will specifically analyze some comics which the Austrian Freedom Party has created some years ago and which were distributed to every school in Austria. And finally, I will come to some conclusions. So I took this picture of The Economist from 2 years ago. where they said, well, the European right-wing populist parties will be traveling in a teapot across the ocean to form the American Tea Party. I guess you know that the US Tea Party started when President Obama was elected into office, and it was basically against his presence as a black president in the White House. There was a lot of racism below this Tea Party fundamentalism. It's not just one ideology, there are many Tea Parties. But it was interesting how in the United States, for the first time, the right wing was talked about in this way. And you see in this nice teapot, which is swimming over the ocean, you see three protagonists of European right-wing populist parties, namely Geert Wilders from the Netherlands, you see Nigel Farage from UKIP, and Marine Le Pen from Front National. And I will come back to these parties. What is important for me are those four dimensions, which I just want to characterize very briefly, and which constitute right-wing populist ideologies. And for me, it's important that right-wing populism is not just a style. Yeah, it's not just rhetoric, it's form and content which come together. And in linguistics, if we talk about meaning, it's always about form and content. It's never just form. So one important ingredient is a virulent nationalism, actually, which is on the borders of nativism. That means actually blood and soil ideology. We see that very strongly, especially in Eastern Europe, where the true Hungarians and the true Poles and the true Bulgarians and Romanians and Ukrainians and so forth are those whose parents have already been born there and so forth, but also those people who are born elsewhere but are being reclaimed into that country as being, for example, real Hungarians. So the question of who belongs and who doesn't belong is a very important question in this debate. The second issue is, of course, populism as a style, a rhetorical style, which every politician has. There is no politician who is not also populist and who sort of claims to be talking for the people or bringing examples of the taxi driver who told them X or something. But in the case of right-wing populist parties, the people, the demos, is defined by the party. So they are representing a very specifically defined people, and they are speaking for this people which they define. So some belong into these people and others don't belong in there. So the question is, who is constructed as us and who's constructed as them? And in that way, they are fundamentally anti-pluralist. So this people is basically defined as homogeneous. So the true Austrians, Hungarians, Americans, whoever, Swedes, Norwegians, are sort of those who are homogeneous. So it's against any diversity. It's against a diverse population. And each of those parties has a specific image of this homo or femina nationalis. And they are also anti-elitist. And if you look at Donald Trump, or now in Austria, the Freedom Party, and also Norbert Hofer's rhetoric, so it's against the establishment, whatever this establishment is supposed to be. In Austria, it's the slogan of Schikaria, which is currently floating around. And basically, it's a very negatively connotated group. It's the elite. They can be money, educational elite, professional elite. It's journalists. It's the media, which are claimed to be lying all the time. Yeah, Lügenpresse. So it's those up there. Yeah, and again, that's not a static group. You can claim people in and claim them out again. The third
ingredient of this sort of cooking stew is authoritarianism. Those parties are very strongly in favor of law and order politics, and they claim that they will again control and do make order. And if you look at the Brexit campaign, take control back was the main slogan of UKIP. We want our control back, and we want to have, you know, law and order. And the fourth ingredient is what conservatism and also a specific variety, which is welfare chauvinism. And conservatism means very conservative values, very traditional values. You see that particularly in gender politics, for example. I guess you have all followed the Polish debates now about abortion. That was one very specific example. And welfare chauvinism means you don't want migration and immigrants because our society would be endangered and there would not be enough money to pay for everybody who would like to come. And what is presupposed is that those people who come would not work. You know, they just come and they take our benefits, while migrants usually come because they want to work and then contribute to taxes, etc. But that is basically the imaginary which is constructed. And now in different countries and in very context-dependent ways, those four dimensions are combined in different ways. Yeah? So we have different historical traditions, different contexts, and you can't really compare, let's say, the Dutch party with the Polish party. Yeah, there are worlds in between, especially in gender politics. But some of these categories or dimensions are quite general and universal. So who are those leaders? And I have just put together a little collage of some, but what is interesting is that all of us are telling us something, yeah, and they're using their fingers. So what means that they are, in when they speak rhetorically, they're very dogmatic, and they are demagogues as well. So one further characteristic of all these parties is that they have a very demagogic rhetoric. And I will come back to this in a minute. But what you see here is on the left from your side is Nigel Farage, who again stepped down as leader of UKIP, but might come there again. Then you have Grillo from the Five Star Movement in Italy. He's not that clearly a right-wing populist. He's certainly a populist, but his party combines various features, and it's not that clearly in this right-wing ideology. Then Geert Wilders from the Dutch party, Frauke Petri from the AfD, Marine Le Pen from Front National, Strache I probably don't have to introduce, and Donald Trump. So you see this huge variety, and they are all very leadership-oriented, those parties, yeah, which also relates to this authoritarianism, yeah, that they are hierarchical parties who are very much leadership-oriented, and the leaders are metonymically standing for that party. So if we just look, just to give you an overview, 2014 were the last European Parliament elections, and there you see that the British National Party, which is basically a fascist party, has dropped. They did win 2009, but then they dropped again. But UKIP was the party which won in the UK, had the most votes at the European Parliament election, and now has dropped again, yeah? Which is the red arrow, if you see that. The party which is rising is the Austrian Freedom Party, which right now stands at the polls of over 30%, sort of 34 about. If we would have elections tomorrow, they would certainly get more than 30%. Then we have the Front National, which also won in France at the European Parliament election. There are elections next year, and it's not clear if possibly Marine Le Pen will be elected as president. And then we have the Italian Lega Nord, which is basically a neo-fascist party. Bossi for a long time was the leader, now it's Salvini. And they're also very anti-migrant, and they are quite low, about 6%. Yeah. And so you see that not everywhere those parties have equally high percentages. In Europe right now, the right-wing populist parties with the highest percentages are the Polish, PIS, Hungary, Fidesz, plus Jobbik, Austria, Switzerland, and France, because UKIP is basically has again fallen. Yeah, so that's sort of, if you like, sort of a broad spectrum. So the question I want to pose right now is how this right-wing populist politics is constructed in public performances, because I thought this is something which might be of interest to this audience, and how they resemiotize their ideologies in various genres. Yeah, on the internet, in comic books. Yeah, they're very creative. Strache also sang some rap songs. I will not play them to you now, but you can find them on his webpage. And what is interesting, the Austrian Freedom Party now also has its own hymn. Yeah, sort of Österreich. Yeah, and if you want to listen to this hymn, also go on the website of the FPÖ. I'm not going to play it here. So basically, why do I talk about politics of fear? My claim is that these parties are so successful because they play into existing anxieties and also reproduce these anxieties and also create anxieties. Yeah? It's obvious that there are legitimate reasons to be afraid. Yeah, there's climate change coming, although the right-wing populists claim that that's not happening, so they deny climate change. But there's climate change happening, there are wars, there's financial crisis, there are lots of problems. The question is what you do with these very complex problems. And one strategy which many of these right-wing populist parties endorse is that they blame a group to be the cause of these very complex problems. So we call that scapegoating. So this is an old mechanism. The Nazis blamed the Jews for all evil in the world, and now some parties still blame the Jews, and others blame the Turks and the Muslims and so forth, the migrants, the refugees, the homo. Sexuals, you know, you can construct whatever group to be at the cause of the problem. And they are then constructed as this group which is endangering us, yeah, this homogeneous nation. And then they construct themselves as knowledgeable to know what to do with that group. Yeah, so if we want to sort of have a good economy again, we have to get rid of the refugees. Yeah, sort of basically, if the refugees or the migration is the cause of the economic crisis, which is obviously not the case, then if we get rid of this, we close our borders, there's nobody allowed to come in, then this crisis will be over. So your third step is a promise, and then to create hope. Yeah, so they will come in as Robin Hood, as the savior of the people, and will get rid of this problem. And it's a very simple strategy. Actually, in German, we call that Sendebotentrick, which the Nazis used and many other parties, totalitarian parties used, in the sense of we are the ones who can save the people from this evil, from this problem, and there's a very simple explanation. And for that to work, for this simplicity and this simplistic problem to work, what those parties do is they endorse what I call the arrogance of ignorance. So people are actually proud to not know. Yeah, this is very strange in enlightenment. Yeah, but I actually claim we are in a post-enlightenment phase, because knowledge is not important anymore. Rationality is not important. What is important is intuition, to feel something. Yeah, and I feel this or I feel that. I don't have to know, and I don't want any authorities and experts to explain anything. Indeed, again, in the Brexit campaign, we had Michael Gove, who was minister of the former government there, say, we've had enough of experts. Yeah, we don't need experts. We don't need knowledge. We don't need education. We all know. And that was also very important in the Tea Party, because Sarah Palin, for example, emphasized that one could have kitchen table economics. So as every housewife knows how to deal with the budget at home, she would also know how to deal with the budget of the United States. And I'm not joking, this is what she actually writes in her book. So in my book, I elaborate that, and it's called kitchen table economics. So why do we need knowledge? Yeah? So just why? So in this way, those simplistic strategies work. Yeah? And they appeal to common sense, to stereotypes, to prejudices, and that seems to work well. So why are migrants, refugees to blame? And here I come also to Sigmund Baumann, but also to Simmel and to other people who have written extensively about the construction of the other. Yeah, and it's always about othering. Who is excluded? Who belongs and who doesn't belong? Yeah, that's at the basis of these discussions. So what I distinguish, according to these theoreticians, is the modern stranger, who was defined by Simmel already long ago, in a famous sociologist, as the Jew. The Jew in Europe was archetypical the stranger, yeah? Because they were inside the society, but they didn't really belong. Yeah? And Simmel writes there, that is so well written, he says, they are non-members, they're not close, but also not distant. Freud also writes about, you know, constructing difference because they are too similar. Yes, it's I think that is very interesting. So we have the strangers within. And you see that, especially in Poland right now, that we have enormous anti-Semitism again, although there are almost no Jews there. You don't have to have the outsiders, the others, to have these fantasies. And then Baumann says we are now confronted also with the postmodern stranger. These are sort of the outcome of neoliberal policies. These are the deprived, weak, and destitute individuals who have to save themselves. Yeah? So they are dependent on themselves in a Darwinian struggle. Yeah? Because if they leave from Afghanistan or Pakistan or Iraq or Syria and somehow travel to Europe across seas and whatever, and if they finally arrive, they are these on their own. They're not a group. They don't belong to any group. And right now we see combinations of these modern and postmodern strangers, again, in different countries in different ways. Baumann then talks about two strategies which are used from countries to cope with these strangers. Namely, on the one hand, you can devour them, you can eat them up, that means assimilate them. On the other hand, they are vomited out, yeah, so you deport them again. So to just give you some elements of right-wing populist rhetoric, because what is important, I think, is to realize that these parties, when they are in debate, go across against all conventions which we are used to. So basically, you cannot really have an argument. Yeah? And I think it's important to understand what they're doing in a way to find a different way of framing debates. So I just want to, well, we've already talked about scapegoating and about dividing groups into the us and them. What is very important is a constant offending of people in a very sort of ad hominem way. So they don't care, they're just offensive. If you listen to Donald Trump, all what he says, it's quite extraordinary, but also politicians in Europe do the same. So they just offend their opponent in an ad hominem way. That means personal characteristic. It's not about an issue. It's not something you can discuss. It's just sort of telling you, like Trump telling some woman that she's ugly or stupid or something. That's not something you can actually discuss. Then terrible exaggeration. Yeah, so issues are exaggerated and constantly repeated. And if you look at debates, it's the same slogans coming over and over again. It doesn't matter what the opponent says, it's just the turns are used to repeat. Yeah, and so that is what stays. Yeah, it's of course something which again is an old strategy which is well known. And what I want to focus on finally is what I call calculated ambivalence. That is, you use one message to convey different meanings, sometimes even contradictory meanings. So Jörg Haider, former leader of the Austrian Freedom Party, used to apologize after some scandal, and then he used to say, actually, I have to apologize, which means I don't really want to apologize, but I apologize. And so for some people, it was okay, he had apologized, but he signaled to his followers that he didn't really mean it. Yeah, so he was forced to apologize. So just to give you another linguistic feature, which is frequently talked about, metaphors. So usually refugees and migrants are talked about as natural catastrophes, as floods and waves and earthquakes and tsunamis, which are dropping into us, or they're talked about illnesses and diseases, they're spreading out, yeah? And frequently then also dehumanized, so like parasites. So you have really some metaphors of which are going back again to Nazi jargon and to the 19th century. And I recently, 3 days ago, I really read a terrible thing in a Danish newspaper. In a Danish village, the right wing distributed hairspray so that people would be able to spray hairspray on refugees as if to exterminate them. Yeah, sort of. So I thought that can't be possible. Yeah. It was in The Guardian. I can give you the link. It was just terrible. So to show you how these metaphors and these slogans are disseminated also via the media, I did another collage of newspaper headlines in the UK. I lived in the UK for the last 10 years. So this is what you see almost every day. This is not sort of just taking the typical examples, yeah? This is sort of a broad range of stuff I've seen every day, which is basically, the slogans of send them all back, yeah? Or we must stop the migrant invasion. So here you have this war metaphor, as if they would come as an army, yeah? Or 150,000 say no to new EU migrants, as if, which is completely obsolete because the EU people are allowed to travel wherever they want in the EU, but they were all merged into the same categories. They don't want to learn English. they are rapists, but we can't throw them out. So you just see how this othering functions via those headlines. But they also function in the rhetoric of politicians. Again, in Denmark, there should be a difference in how the country welcomes a Christian American or Sweden, a Muslim Somali or Pakistani. There is a danger that the cohesion of our society, and this is the fear, yeah? They are threatening to us, can be threatened in the future if we do not dare put right and reasonable requirements for those coming to Denmark. So here you see how easily a difference is constructed between Christian Americans and Muslims, Somali or Pakistani, and those are threatening our society. So what my framework actually where I say is it's all about protecting the nation as a body. And if you again know German Volkskörper, this was a notion which is very important in fascism and National Socialism. It's not coincidental that the AfD, Frauke Petri, wants to bring back the notion of Völkisch. Yeah? And we see that this body politics is then the nation is seen as a family, this in-group, and basically as the strict father who is sort of protecting this nation as a body, as a family. Okay, I want to come to my first example. I don't know if you've ever seen this comic book, The Blue Planet by the Austrian Freedom Party, but this is one of the pictures, and I thought it really fits to this fear of the city or about the city, because here you can see what the negative, the dystopia of Vienna looks like. So what does it look like? It looks like we have all these different languages which are symbolized with different orthographic symbols. You have Cyrillic alphabet, Arabic, Hebrew, Iranian, Farsi, and all of that. Then you have the St. Stephen's Cathedral with a half moon on top. So Islam has colonized Christianity. And then you have all kinds of sort of word creations which insinuate certain, for example, Yiddish, yeah, where it says Scheiße Pap, yeah. So you have a play of words, a play with languages, which is supposed to symbolize this multikulti, yeah, which they don't want. And also you have symbols implemented into the city landscape. Yeah, so this is the dystopia. What will happen if this so-called invasion by others comes? And it flies on a sort of blue saucer, like a, Star Wars or something, Harte Strache, yeah, the Freedom Party to save Vienna. Yeah, so I think this is sort of really metaphorically manifesting what I just talked about, the way this is now designed, yeah, this dystopia of the colonization of our cities by others. And he says, sort of Strache, who comes in this interesting blue spaceship, yeah, he says, that this will be now a celebrity firework when he comes, and they say, no, this is just a little gang war which is happening. So we have criminality, all the prejudice and stereotypes is implemented in here. So how do we keep strangers out? Walls, yeah? So I don't even have to tell you much about walls. Everybody's talking about walls and borders and how we create them and how we build them, and with barbed wire or not barbed wire. And Donald Trump says, for example, it's going to be a great wall. This will be a wall with a big, very beautiful door, because we want the legals to come back into the country. So this is against Mexico. And there is this distinction between legal and illegal, yeah? But who are the illegal? Again, this is an arbitrary definition. And our former Minister of the Interior said, without better protection of the EU's exterior borders, that situation will be impossible to get under control. So it's about getting control back. We must build a fortress Europe, yeah? So this is to keep the others out. So this is how we protect in order not to have this invasion, as it is said. And so Trump uses the slogan of making America great again, which again is very similar to what we hear in Europe, Österreich zuerst, Deutschland zuerst, France first, and so on. This is. So those people promise to save the country, the country will be great again, it will be important. And basically what Trump, I also have this example here where he insults, as you know, all kinds of journalists and calls them scum and really bad words. And what is interesting with Trump, but also others, is it doesn't matter what he says. Yeah, he gets away with everything. And why is that? Because our conventional rules, the maxims of conversation, are not applicable. Yeah? And I think that's very important, how to deal with them. You shouldn't even hope to be able to engage in a discussion. I think that politicians need to understand it doesn't work. Yeah, whatever we learned previously doesn't work that way. You will not win a debate. So in argumentation, we use these frames or these kinds of diagrams. This is a topos, yeah, the topos of savior. So this is the argument: Austria is in danger, too many foreigners are here, our budget can't make it. So we need to trust Strache to defend the city. Yeah, and this is basically the main underlying argument which we encounter in those debates. I have a second example. Do I still have about 5 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. So I would just want to rush through another one of these examples from the comic books. Which was about Austria and Vienna winning over the Turks. Now, you probably, most of you know, and all of us learned that in school very frequently, two dates, 1529 and 1683. These were the two sieges by the Turkish Ottoman army to Vienna, and both times Vienna was saved. And by saving Vienna from this Turkish siege, Christianity was saved, yeah? Europe was saved from the Ottoman invasion. And this is a very important narrative in Austrian history. And basically, Strache in a comic book, which was distributed to every school in Austria and every household, so they have a lot of money, Strache incorporates Prince Eugene, who saved with the Austrian army, the Habsburg army, saved Vienna from the Turks. And he appears and actually incites this little boy to use a sling against the Mustafa. So he tells this little boy, now here he's performing the leader, and he says, based on the script David versus Goliath, yeah, he says, why don't you go against this big Ottoman army? Yeah, and use your sling with a stone. Yeah, so this is clearly an insinuation of the religious theme in the Old Testament. And the current major is down there. Yeah, this is insinuating Michael Heuper, who's shown as fat, old, and in this red sort of clothes, whereas Strache is young, thin, and very energetic. Yeah, with so you see these dichotomies also designed into the picture. That's, I think it's in a, done in a very clever way, yeah? And so what he does now is that he incites this young boy to use the stone sling against Mustafa, yeah? And the young boy then succeeds with this stone, and then he comes back to Strache, i.e. Prince Eugene, and says, okay, now I get my reward. Because Strache had, Eugene promised him a certain sausage and a certain kind of bread if he actually succeeds in hitting Mustafa. Now, the Green Party went to court about this because they said this is hate incitement. But they didn't win because the Freedom Party said, well, this is fiction. This is just a comic book. So you can't be accused, you know, in fiction you can do anything. And I, from a linguistic point of view, would say this is exactly this calculated ambivalence. Because as he explicitly says that he incorporates Prince Eugene, there's also a subtext of reality in there. But of course, it's also fiction. And whatever is addressed, you can draw back from. So it's a way, so they obviously were not accused, and also there was no sentence about that. So here you had what we call the topos of history, which is combined with this topos of savior, and you have sort of, this would have terrible consequences. Historically, the siege had terrible consequences, and this can be compared with now. At that time, there were Turks. Now we have Turks and other people standing in front of Vienna, and the Freedom Party will keep them out, like Prince Eugene did. Now, interestingly, in all these historical narratives, there are, of course, many different versions. And when I gave this example once to a Polish student of mine, he said, well, listen, in Warsaw, in the gallery there, in the museum, there's a picture that actually the Polish army saved Vienna, and not Prince Eugene. They did it together, actually. But Sobieski, the Polish king, came down the Kahlenberg and saved Vienna with the Polish army. So the Poles actually take this for themselves without the Austrians. So you have an example of different historical narratives. So I come to my conclusions. What is the reason for all of this working that well? Well, there are many reasons. Of course, there are different crises. There's the question of securitization, because there is terror, so many of our human rights have been cut, and there's surveillance everywhere, and they can work with this very well. The law and order topic works very well with sort of emerging terrorism. Racism is sort of pushed back in favor of what we call culturalization. So we don't talk about races, but we talk about different cultures. And their culture doesn't fit to our culture. Yeah? So there is this culturalization of discourse. We have the anti-establishment because there are many privileges, and there is, of course, a big gap between rich and poor, and salaries have not risen. So there's a lot of anger which can be used and instrumentalized. And we have very clever celebrity politicians who can stage themselves very well. We have professional ways of dealing with the social media and all of that. We have designers. So there's a lot of money invested, a commodification of politics. So all of that comes together in different ways in different countries. And I've put on top insecurity and uncertainty, which is what Bauman says. The more insecure we feel, the more uncertain, the more simple answers we need. Yeah? And if you can give those simple answers, you obviously get a lot of voters. So there are two short-term strategies to encounter that. One is isolate these parties, which has happened in France for a long time. You have a cordon sanitaire, yeah? The right and left vote together to keep Le Pen out. That was successful up to now. Or you take them in, which happened in Austria, for example. Entzaubern was the word, and we all know what happened. Or you have long-term strategies, which I think must be education, so we shouldn't resign and let enlightenment vanish. But it's important also to know how to deal with these various genres and ideologies and discussion techniques in a better way. I think one needs to actually have programs to counter that. And one of my programs is that I would actually like different kinds of borders. This is a Turkish artist. I love this poster. Because it shows how one could imagine sort of an utopia where we would have flexible borders or borders which could be used for something else. Thank you very much.
Thank you.